Hi, Al. So last episode, we had talked about technical debt. And in this episode, we will look at how technical debt manifests itself and what is its connection with agile development. Can we help handle that better? How will it work? So we have Nirosh and Priya, who are senior architects, and we will discuss with them and learn from their experience on how it has worked well for them and how did it manifest. So Nirosh, can you share in some instance of where you saw this technical debt manifesting? Like everything is going perfectly well, you thinking that the customer is going to give you accolades, and then something completely different happens when you are at the final stage or when you're going for a renewal of a contract.
Yes, I have a very interesting story that goes in line with your question. So we had one engagement with a product company where they had true agile teams. When I say true agile teams, you understand that most of the time when you practice agile, what you do is you have a fixed deadline, and then you change the requirement in agile manner, but you have to deliver it on time with a fixed deadline. So this is not like that. So that it was true agile. They wanted to expand their project team, so that they had three teams, and now they invited us to take part in the delivery so that they can increase the volume of the delivery. So it was a product that we were developing. And at the beginning, we were in par with those teams according to the numbers and according to the Scrum Master. So she was so committed, and we were committed as well, where we had established a lot of new processes, especially since it was a product. We established new processes to govern the architecture of overall architecture of the solution as well. So given that we were doing so many new things, we were very happy and they were happy as well. As an example, when we do our agile estimations and planning, there was a Scrum Master from US waking up at 2 a.m. In the night to help us and work with us to help us clarify requirements. So that kind of very close relationship and commitment we had from both teams. So we were doing so well and we were very happy. But at the end of the first year, when the invoices were raised to close the first year engagement, we realized that some of those stakeholders like CEO of the company and then the finance head and marketing teams were not happy with our delivery. Mainly have 11 allegations covering three main areas. One is our overall throughput. The other one is the quality of the work. Third one was we were not, according to them, aligned to their overall product roadmap. So our delivery was not aligned to their overall product roadmap. So we were surprised and we were not sure how to handle that. So in my viewpoint, we did everything right. But then we were clueless as to how to handle that at the end of that.
Using our favorite analogy, you were a Titanic claiming to be the best possible ship, and you hit an iceberg and you sunk.
That is correct.
Interesting. And that's after doing Agile. And you have this project manager waking up at 2 a.m. in the morning.
Yes.
Very interesting.
So she is from...
Wow. Okay. What else? I feel your pain. So, Priya, interestingly, when we talk of Agile, right, there is a quasi-Agile and then there is a genuine Agile that happens in projects, okay? Can you share some experience of where we can actually see the difference between how a quasi-Agile looks like versus how a genuine Agile looks like?
Hi, Kumaran. First, let me talk about the genuine Agile project which I have worked. I don't think I have worked on any other such a smooth project before or after that. We do have, as usual, as in Agile, we used to have this everyday scrum calls and weekly status reports. Apart from this, this product owner used to conduct weekly status meetings across the stakeholders. When I say stakeholders, it's not just business stakeholders and the technical people and the vendors across this project. He also used to pull around the project sponsor and the financial stakeholders as well. Okay. So to that extent, everyone used to be clear like what's going on in the project. And every time when we make a release 2 weeks once or 3 weeks once, we used to come to know about the issues then and there. And the shocks at the end were pretty much less. That's what I would say. And this had helped them a lot, such that they can plan for the fun for the upcoming phases as well. And this had really improved their credibility and the trust or the collaboration with the project sponsor had really improved there. Not only that, the QA team or the infrastructure team or the development team across who were spread across geos and vendors, we were all collaborating so well. It was quite going on in a very friendly manner rather than like a battleground. So this was one instance where we followed genuine agile. But when we talk about a quasi-agile, there was another project. In fact, that was one of my recent projects where the iterations were identified and then all the stakeholders were involved. But the proper meetings or the scrum calls, as mentioned in Agile, were not followed. And finally, we ended up like a waterfall model on the name of Agile.
So interestingly, you said your weekly Agile calls had actually people who were from finance, and the Agile calls were also used to readjust the project and the project needs as well. Not just the technical need or just the use case story.
Yes, that's right.
That's brilliant. The collaboration between the business stakeholders, the one who's giving the money, the infrastructure team and the app, everything became friendly. I love the phrase that you used, it became friendly.
It was quite transparent process. Like nothing was hidden from us. I was only a lead. I don't need to know anything. Like in other projects, though I'm an architect, I don't come to know about the fund sponsor details every time. Like probably it may come as a news to me over there at a later point of time. But in that particular project, it was quite pretty transparent. All the details were shared across.
That's pretty interesting. It also, just as a team lead, you were just a team lead there, but you could have so much insight about the project. Thanks, Priya. So interesting, you know, the first year was a disaster. Right, when whatever you said, like it was a mess, and then even though you were doing Agile, and then the second year, what happened? You managed to do a turnaround. How did that happen, and what were you able to do to make that happen?
Second year, at the end of the first year, it was a surprise, but then by the time the invoice raised, there were 11 allegations, as I said, mainly related to code quality and the throughput and the
alignment to the project roadmap. Okay.
That we took a step back, and then we had to give them a discount because it's part of the negotiation. I don't blame the customer as well.
Right.
So it's expected. So that when you negotiate at that level, we didn't have enough data to prove that their allegations are wrong. According to them, so we were not delivering enough value for the money they're paying, so that we can give them a discount. Okay. And then with the discount, we regained their trust. One of the things we did is the financials were handled at the end of the year for this particular customer because of the true relationship, that the very high friendly relationship we had with this customer. But then we break it into agile pieces so that at the end of every cycle, we start raising and closing the
invoice. Okay. Yeah.
That's one thing we did. The other one is the code quality. So that we introduce a global standard to measure the quality. And then at the end of every week, we publish a particular report, a weekly report. And that this report, the code quality report, was included as part of this report. That was addressed, the quality issue was addressed by comparing us with the global standard. Say, as an example, for C# code or Java code, there are globally accepted standards, so that we compare ourselves with those standards so that it's globally above average.
Okay.
So we brought up that level. So that's one of the things that we did. And then for the capacity or the volume point of view, there were allegations saying that our team is about 40% productive compared to their teams.
Okay.
So that we came with a different strategy, a friendly strategy, so that randomly we identify certain stories that say, as an example, Team 1, which is a US team, already did. And then that story is secretly included as part of our story.
Nice. Okay.
Yes. And then we were asked to do the estimate for those as well. So slowly we align ourselves, our basis, story basis, so that they are equal to other teams' basis. So that all the teams really come to the same page, so that when you compare a story size, it's an apple to apple type comparison.
So we took
all these stakeholders who made allegation as part of this engagement, so that they know what we do. And then we discuss with them and agreed that, okay, if you do it this way, then we can compare it in apple to apple data. Because in Agile, it's very difficult to compare the sizes or the velocity in apple to apple basis. So we came up with these strategies. And then, as Priya mentioned, one of the most important thing is that we failed to identify the project team required for this Agile engagement. So we included the finance team as well as the CEO and the CS team in certain teams, certain Agile meetings, like at the end of the closure, the acceptance time. So those people also comes, and then they ask certain questions from some of those people who go through the technical aspect and then feel comfortable about our delivery.
Nice. So
that way we managed to handle that. And at the end of the second year also, there were certain concerns raised, but then we were better prepared at that time so that we didn't have to give discount at that time. And then eventually, now that it's about like 6 years now with that company, now it has grown.
So it has grown. That's nice. The trust has also got. That's actually an interesting point, that you are able to kind of even not just discount, kind of upsize the contract. The trust has gone up because you're able to show value as well. So what were the cycle times that you had decided, and how did you decide on that cycle time?
Initially, since there was a lot of issues, initially CEO and the customer representative as well as the finance people took part in the meeting at the end of the sprint.
Okay.
For like all of sprints. And then slowly they regained the trust. They used to ask questions from their technical people as well during those meetings to regain their trust. And then as they feel comfortable with us, that intensity slowly decays. But
that's nice. So essentially, I guess you had these, it was initially at roughly around 3 weeks where you got them involved because there was a lot of worry and concern. And then you still had the scrum meetings, and then they will join on the need basis. But as the trust increased, you could actually make it happen. But I guess one key thing between what you and Priya was telling is that the involvement of the finance or the budgets or the actual business stakeholder becomes a key part of your Agile process. So you expanded the scope from the technical team to the finance, the budget, the other stakeholders also, which kind of made it smooth, reduced tension, increased trust. And I love the way Priya put it. It made us all very friendly. Okay. That was great. Thanks, Priya, and thanks, Nirosh, for joining. We'll see you in a fortnight's time. Thanks all for listening as well. Thank you.
Thank you.